I'm going to talk about improving Java build performance with Gradle 5. Maybe quick question up front, like, who's using Gradle? Okay, who's doing Android development? Okay, really not. And the others are Java, backend stuff, server. Okay, good. Interesting, because like originally that talk was named Improving Java and Android Build Performance, and they asked me to ditch some Android specifics. So who am I? Just a quick note so you can think what it's worth, what I'm talking about. Like, my name is René, I live in Berlin. I'm a Gradle core committer since a while now and doing that full time since 2012 now. I'm an employee of Gradle Inc., like the company behind Gradle. I like coding, talking, eating, and because I like eating so much, I need to do some sports, but as you can see, I'm better at eating than at doing sports so far. You can reach me via Twitter or GitHub, or drop me email if I would put that there. If you have any questions regarding Gradle or anything build related. So all of you know Gradle, so we can make that section quick. So what is Gradle? Gradle is a built-in automation tool. Like it's JVM based, like it's mostly written in Java, even though some people think that it's mainly maybe Groovy or lately Kotlin. The 99% of it is written in pure Java. Just the DSL on top is Groovy or Kotlin, depending on what you're using. It's free and open source, as you should all have checked before use. Sometimes I hear that, I left that here as a note, that Gradle is not the Gradle plugin for Android, and it's not Android Studio. Like, especially in the Android world, there's quite some misconception, like, where does Gradle start, where's the IDE starts, where's it responsible of the Android team to do things. Like, I see a lot of hate speech on Twitter regarding Gradle and Android sometimes, so just to clarify that. It's an agnostic build tool. Like, we started with Java and support naturally like most languages on the JVM, like Groovy, Kotlin, Scala, then Android, obviously. But we also like build or support C, C++, Swift, and there's some other stuff. Like, for example, I did my slides with ASCII Doctor and Gradle. We have some plugins for other ecosystems like Go, if you have a diverse infrastructure and might have to unify your build tools. Great, that's what we think Gradle is a good option for. We have 9 million downloads per month, and we are like, I just thought I skipped that part because you all know it already. We have currently like 35 engineers working on Gradle or Gradle Enterprise. I come later on to that part. So there's a lot of traction going on, and there's a lot of development going on. I wanted to skip that part. If you're interested in Gradle or in the build domain at all, like as every company, I guess, we are hiring. And you can work from home, actually. That's what I find basically cool. Like, I put jeans on today, but usually I don't put on pants. But for you, because when you work from home, like, you get used to things. So when I handed in that talk, like, there was a question, like, why does it matter? Like, people use IntelliJ, or I guess you use IntelliJ? How much IntelliJ? NetBeans? Oh, okay. Eclipse? Lost souls. There was this discussion about why builds matter, because you do it in the IDE and stuff. And so the build tool is not part of that in your daily life. Actually, I think that first is wrong, and second is also changing. Like, imagine like you have a build that wastes like 60 seconds each time, and you have 50 builds per day, and you have like 10 developers. I made those numbers up, so I get to 8 hours wasted per day. That's actually one workday developer, at least in Germany, 8 hours. I don't know how much you work here. And that does not even consider the loss of focus you have during your development. Like, changing context is very, like, you everyone knows it. It's like super expensive to have. And don't get me even started on the morale, right? Like if things take a while, it's depressing, like it's bad for your morale. And usually what you do, like I noticed that in former companies I worked, is that you attract the wrong people if you're wasting time and have time to, or the wrong developers to do other stuff than working. Like good developers or productive developers want to have productive tools, so that's why it's important. I split it up a bit in general advice, and then I go a bit more into details, like how you can make your builds faster. The good thing is that since all of you are using Gradle already, or most of you, I skip most introduction stuff, right? Like, I don't tell you how to create a task or something, like, at least not in detail. So before we start looking into build performance, it's like, I see that all the time that people complain on Twitter or at clients or somewhere that, oh, my build is slow, but what does that really mean? Like, what is slow for you? Is the CI server slow? Is the IDE sync slow, where you have IntelliJ delegating to Gradle, for example, which is now the default, I think, since the last version? So you really need to be specific on what is slow and what you want to improve, actually. So the first thing we do is like we set up a process. The process I'm talking about here is actually the one we use internally. Like we have plenty of performance tests, and for example, when we work with the Google team on Android support, we also follow exactly that same process here. So the first thing you need to do is define a scenario you want to improve. Like, that could be your CI builds are too slow, or the whole pipeline is too slow. Maybe it takes, I don't, like I've been to clients where they say, we used to have a nightly build, but when I come in the office in the morning, it's not done yet. Then you might have a problem and should look into that earlier. Or it's just the developer build to take, like, let's say these 60 seconds each time you invoke it. And it depends a bit on how you work, but I don't even count like how often I invoke a build process. And so maybe it's a smaller thing that you have your developer builds locally running slow. Or it's a certain environment, maybe your Windows boxes are slow or something like that. Of course, that I totally made that up. It could be Linux too, it's not just Windows. So define your scenario and then profile your scenario. Talk about that later, what to do best here. And then the first thing I would always do is identify the biggest bottleneck. Like often you have things like, I know how to fix that, which is a minor thing, like, I don't know, you some optimized code structure, and it really, often it does not really matter. Like we take a look at what usually matters most in build performance. Then fix that bottleneck, and then not just fix your bottleneck and commit and hooray, go home. Verify that your fix is actually working and not introducing something else, or maybe there's something you missed or things actually now completely changed. So verify your fix before you move on. And then last but not least, like, repeat that till you're happy, till you think you got to a point where your build is as fast as it could get. So regarding the measure your build performance, we as a build tool like Gradle, we provide a tool, or we internally use a tool that we made open source, which we call the Gradle Profiler. That allows you to automate your measurements. Like that's, for example, that's what we call a scenario file. So what you have here is like, I have two scenarios declared, assemble, which just produces your production code, let's say. And then I have another scenario that I want to look more deeply into, which I call a clean build. Like a clean build in terms like building from scratch with nothing being compiled before or anything. And what I can do in that profiling or in that measurements is I can automatically declare which versions of Gradle I want to run. Like that's super helpful. Like let's say you consider an update to Gradle and you don't know if it's worth the effort. So what you can do is like you can just declare a scenario at the version you're currently using and at the one that you might want to switch to, or the new latest release. Like Gradle releases like every 6 weeks. So if you want to keep up with that, you need some automation, or you should invest some time in looking that you actually make use of that. Then you can declare some tasks. Here it's just clean. Then you can configure all kind aspects of Gradle arguments or system properties if you have a flag something. And then you can declare like how to run it. Like typically that could be like the tooling API. That's how, for example, you would mimic like how you invoke a Gradle test from IntelliJ, because IntelliJ or the other IDEs, they use a tooling API. Or you can say, okay, invoke it from the command line interface, or especially don't use a daemon here, like, because that's the scenario I have. And then you can declare like how many runs you want to do, how many warm-up runs you want to do. And then actually you can just benchmark it. So let's how you invoke it. And then what you get is you get a report. It's one part of that report actually. So you see here I made a change in my configuration. So there's a new configuration I use the same Gradle version though. And then what I see is like the green dots. Can you see the? Yeah, I think you can, right? So typically the green dots take longer. So the old config takes longer. So my build was improved by my change in configuration. Maybe. Yeah, I have that report over here. I did that this morning. So you get this overview here, but what you also get is like a summary of how much time you save or you degraded your performance. That's a helpful tool for benchmarking your build and to have repetitive results, and also like avoid this works for me scenario, like that's what you don't want to have. Another thing relatively easy to do is like stay up to date. So typically what you are working on as a build tool engineering team is actually performance. Like nobody ever complained about the build being too fast. Usually it's the opposite. So that's what you're constantly working on. So that's what Gradle is constantly working on, and making things faster. And that's also true like for the whole ecosystem. Like, so check that your Gradle wrapper version, I hope, who's using Gradle and not the wrapper? We have to talk after that, why you do that, but you should not. But yeah, that's the easiest way to do it. And also like with Android, it's the same. Like when the latest Android plugin comes out, that relies usually on newer APIs that are in the newer Gradle version, so you need to update all of them. There are also like third-party plugins that might use newer API we see later on or not, so try to be up to date. And there's also like, that's mostly important for I guess Android developers actually, is that annotation processors, they also improved a lot over the last year or so, because like one big thing we saw is that annotation processors usually broke incremental builds, because you could never tell if the annotation processor produces the reproducible output. So we fixed that in Gradle, and some annotation processors picked that up. I have later an overview of that. Then another thing, like I was told like here at that conference that people are really eager into JVM internals tuning, like going hardcore in like configuring flags I haven't heard about, and it's all about bytecode. I don't have much bytecode actually, so sorry. But here for the sake of the build, it should be really enough to provide enough heap space. Like the other tweaks you do with some flags to GC or I don't know, some other internals in the JVM, I never saw something really meaningful that makes sense in for the build tool, like not for your production system or whatever. I can't talk about that, of course, but for how to use Gradle, it never helped a lot. Like I never see something that really was worth the effort. Instead, spend your time on structural improvements, which we will look into now. And then one last thing for that general overview is that you should use the Gradle daemon. If the Gradle daemon is enabled by default since Gradle 3.0, I think, it provides a number of in-memory caches, which makes it very efficient, especially for repetitive builds. Like if you have it on your command line or for CI environment, like we cache a lot of stuff that we can reuse in later invocations of Gradle. So for example, all the compiled build scripts or the plugin classes you use in your build that are kept in memory, the class loader hierarchy for those is also kept in memory. As you're using Gradle, I guess you have an idea how that task input and output caching is working. So even those hashes are also kept in memory. So that, and even dependency resolution metadata, we keep to some degree in memory to make next invocations even faster. So usually, the more often you use your Gradle daemon, the faster your build should get. So do not disable it. If you need to disable it for whatever reason, actually you have a problem. And that might be a plugin that leaks memory or something that you should address in the plugin and not by just disabling the daemon. Like you use a lot of good optimizations. So to continue on how or where to improve your build, we need to recap on how the build lifecycle in Gradle works. So actually in Gradle there are like, yeah, some say three, some say two phases. I listed them here explicitly, three. So you have that initialization phase where you read the setting script and you read, like you get the basic information, you start the daemon if it's not running yet, you start the JVM at all. You get the basic idea of the project structure here, and then you have that configuration phase. That's the second phase. That's actually, I have slides for each. So here you have that setting script. That's actually part of the initialization phase. Here you tell how does the structure of your build looks like. So every time that is wasted or that you waste in the setting script, for example, is part of the initialization phase. The next phase is the configuration phase. Usually that's quite important one to optimize for two reasons. First of all, like there's a lot of build logic here usually, like depending on how big your project is. I'm not talking about you build a SLF4J API jar. I guess the build is done in 3 seconds or something. There's not much to optimize there, but usually I guess your projects are a little bit more complex and you have a lot more plugins or sub-projects. So here's where you can really optimize. And the important bit here is actually that all the code you execute during the configuration phase, applying plugins, applying scripts, evaluating, having after evaluate hooks, stuff like that, is executed every single time you invoke Gradle. It doesn't even matter like which task you invoke, because the configuration phase actually configures your project, and that needs to be done every single time. Like you, Gradle cannot tell like don't apply the Java plugin because the Java task was not invoked or anything. So that's why it's so important to have that configuration phase as low as possible. So you even invoke it for Gradle help or Gradle W tasks. I remember a couple of years ago, like we are working on improving that constantly faster. So then there's an execution phase, and in a typical build where you actually produce something, I'm not talking about Gradle help or Gradle tasks, so actually compiling stuff or building something. The execution phase usually takes way longer than the configuration phase. If not, that's a good indicator to look into that. So The execution phase is actually request. First of all, you calculate the requested tasks that you want to execute, like by what you invoked from the command line, like which tasks you requested there, and the declared dependencies on that task. And then after that, Gradle executes those tasks. Like it creates a graph, and then it walks down that graph. Like in a parallel or a singular session or a manner, that depends on how you configured it, but that's what the execution phase basically is. So how do you figure now out where the problem is? Is it the configuration phase in your build? Is it the init phase, or is it the execution phase? One option you have to figure that out is actually build scans. Build scans is a service we provide as a public free service that you can publish like metadata about your build to a service we provide at scans.gradle.com. It provides you tremendously insights of your build and where time was spent and what to optimize and stuff like that. Before I go on and you try it out, like it's public, like the URL you get, like you get a custom URL per build scan, is like it's not hidden by a password or anything. So if you provide or if you publish a public build scan, be aware that I don't know, if you work on private stuff or in your enterprise company, you might not be able to use the free service. So try it on your pet project maybe first. The way to enable it, like the easiest way, is to run your build with --scan. There's a documentation about how to always generate a build scan, and you have plenty of configuration options there that you can look up. But one thing you get is actually that performance drill down. So here I have an overview of where my time was spent during the build. So I see like the total build time was like 2.3 seconds. And here I see that execution phase was rather quick. And the initialization phase and configuration phase was quite slow. You also get insights about your memory usage. So that's not a problem. Like, and order, like 100 milliseconds is, I think it's okay. Like, usually we say like if you spend like more than 3 or 4% on garbage collection, you should take a look. So there are some red flags good numbers here. So if your startup and settings and build source building takes more than 1 second, you should take a look into that. Usually, like most of the time, it should be up to date, so it should really not be more than that. And configuration time, that's a little bit more complex because like it depends really on how much projects you build. Like there's, for example, LinkedIn, for example, they build, I don't know, 4,000 sub-projects or something. Like you must make that configuration time, like the red flag, a bit more dependent on the size. But about like 10 milliseconds per project, that should be enough on configuration time. Another thing, like especially when you're using Gradle already, so a single line of change in your code somewhere, wherever, should not trigger a full rebuild. Like if you see something like that, check your configuration, check your dependencies. And if you haven't changed anything, like you invoke Gradle build and Gradle build again, there should not be anything be re-executed. Like there should nothing be recompiled or anything, or process resources done again. And also like check the garbage collection time. Like I saw some clients where they say like, oh, it's super slow, because then they ended up having a typo in the XMX parameter settings or something like that. So use a daemon, I mentioned that already. Then another thing to avoid in general during initialization and configuration phase is like file.io. So that's a thing I see quite often, that you go to the, like what you do is you iterate over the directories in your project, and you just like, you read those directories and include them as a project in your build. It's pretty convenient to do so, but depending on the size of your project, it's more and more work. Like here it's pretty simple, but often like, even if you configure the build file name and stuff, that's all IO operation. And yeah, file IO, no matter if it's like cached by the Java JVM here to some degree, it's still way more expensive than plain in-memory stuff. So, and if you don't add projects like on a daily basis, the time you save here to include that project explicitly is kind of minimal, right? Like, given that you execute that build maybe 1,000 times per week or something. Another typical thing I see is that configurations are resolved during configuration time. Like you have dependencies and they are downloaded during the configuration phase. That's not what you want. Like there's no, like I haven't found a good use case where that actually makes sense to do. Like you need it to compile, so then it should be downloaded as part of that compile task. So what you can do, what you can see here is that I run Gradle help, which basically mimics just executing the configuration phase. And I see that a compile configuration was resolved. How can I fix that? You need to check where that compile configuration is actually used. One quite typical use case is you create a fat jar, or others say uber jar, to bundle your application in one big jar. And what you do here is like you have some custom configuration of which dependencies to include. And here's the culprit code that does this resolution. Like here you have the compile configuration, and then that collect here is like a Groovy operation, which is eager. Like as soon as you call that, it's executed. So that is a configuration phase of your task. So it's executed as part of the configuration of your build. So that configuration will be resolved during configuration phase, even if you don't even build that jar or so. So what you can do to fix that is actually quite simple in that case. Put it in curly brackets, which tells Gradle to be lazy evaluated instead. So it will only be executed as soon as you actually require that that fat jar here. It's a typical example of an easy fix, but hard to find. Yeah, that's where build scans are definitely helpful. If you can't use build scans, the best way to, you would need some custom code to detect that in your build script, actually. IO at configuration time, I mentioned that already. So here, for example, I have a pretty simple script here that I call stats.gradle. We have some custom code added to write some statistics about my plugin or my build, and it actually takes way more than expected, like way more than all the other scripts and plugins. So let's take a look over there. That's like the error you have here is like, I claim that everyone who ever used Gradle and wrote custom tasks ran into that, me included. Like, who sees the problem here? Huh. Sorry? Exactly. Ah, good. Thank you. So what do we see? You declare a task like project stats, but what you do, like the whole logic of creating that statistics and put that in a file is done during that configuration phase of that task. What you actually want to do, and that's why I said like that's what everybody misses at least once when he uses Gradle, is that, and uses custom tasks, that you need to put that in the do last block to ensure that this logic here is executed only when you actually trigger that task. So here you would you run Gradle help and you would see, oh, that stats file is created. Weird. So that's one first step to fix that. So that reduces the I/O at configuration time. It reduces the configuration time or the logic at all. One way to go even further is like implement your custom Gradle task for that. That makes it way less error prone to step into that problem. Like here you declare, it's very declarative way of doing that. Like you declare your class, input files, output files, all the stuff you know, I guess. And then you put that logic here. And then in your build script, you actually only need to configure it. And that makes it way less error prone. With Gradle 5, actually, we can go one step further. Like what I said earlier is like here, you have that task configuration, which is executed every time you invoke a build. And if you have a build with, I don't know, 100 plus projects, like you have a lot of tasks and you have a lot of tasks to configure. So even that, executing these blocks take quite some time. So what we introduce in Gradle 5 actually is a task avoidance API that actually offloads the configuration of that task from that configuration phase as good as possible. So this, instead of task create or task name, whatever, you use task register, give it a name, give the task class you use, and then that looks similar. That's a configuration block we saw earlier, but it's actually executed only if that task is really needed in that build. So for example, if another task depends on it and that is required. So imagine if you have a lot of tasks in your build, and for example, like Android definitely has that with all the variant types and all tasks of that, you save a lot of time here, even though it's per unit, maybe small, but in sum, it's quite worthy. Another thing, especially if you use custom plugins, maybe written by your own, maybe resolved from the plugins portal, you should double check how they perform or how they work, at least to some degree. You have an inefficient plugin. What I do here actually is like I have a build script that part I put it in build script for simplicity, but it could be like also plugin, right? So what I do here is I resolve the version for my project from Git. Like I want the Git hash to be my version number. That's totally fine and like valid use case. But the problem here is actually not that code. That might be per se the expensive part, but what makes it even worse is that I apply it to all projects. Like, as I said, like if you have one project, okay, that doesn't matter, but then you also wouldn't use all projects. But if you have like hundreds of sub-projects, you would invoke that Git command like 100 times in the configuration phase to resolve that same version and again and again and again. So that should be fixed. One pattern you can use is like reuse this expensive logic. Like what I do instead here is like I still have that version.gradle file we saw earlier, but then what I actually do is I only apply it on the root project. So I invoke that Git command once. I have that version on the root version then, on the root project version. And then for all my sub projects, I just reuse that already configured logic. So that saves you a lot of time. General advice, extract your build logic into script plugins or real plugins later. That makes finding issues way much easier. And extract to binary plugins where possible. Like that makes it like binary plugins, they don't need to be like even Gradle optimizes and has these in memory caches. Like script plugins, like if they get more complex, they get more expensive because you often need to recompile them and reevaluate and stuff. So if you have binary plugins, you have, first of all, you compile them once and can reuse them. You have proper dependency management to resolve the right version and stuff. So do that. You can start doing that by putting things under build source and later on move that maybe in a separate project to version it or not. Then one thing I advise is like use static compilation. Like you can write your plugins and task in all kinds of JVM-based languages, Java, Groovy, Kotlin, Scala, if you like. But make sure you compile static. So for example, I know you wonder, static, like, okay, Kotlin clear, but how to do that in Groovy? Like in Groovy, you can use that add compile static annotation that actually removes all that dynamic logic you Groovy adds on top, which makes, especially if you have a lot of computations in your plugin or stuff, makes that way more or way slower. So use compile static. Yeah. And then, like, once you have done all that and your configuration phase is still slow, then you might use other tools to optimize on the algorithmic level. Like, I barely use I barely see plugins that are that complicated, but maybe, like, it could happen, right? So I heard you guys love these flame graphs. So what you can do actually with the profiler, like I earlier mentioned that you can benchmark a build to compare before and after or something, but you can also do profiling here. Let me find that command, profile. So what I do here is, instead of running with dash dash benchmark, the same Gradle profiler as showed earlier, is like I run dash dash profile, and in this case, I use JFR. I say, now for demo reasons, I only use like two iterations to make it quicker. And then I point to the project I want to profile and the scenario file. And once when I do that, I can see that the profiler invokes Gradle multiple times. Here you see I have two warm-up builds. I have two builds running, like that's my iterations flag here. And I use a JFR profiler. That takes a while, but just like in a good cook show, I prepared something. So what you get out of that is like you get different reports, but one thing you get, for example, let's take that one, is flame graphs. So what you can do here is actually you can have a raw flame graph. Sorry. And that actually shows all the whole stack that was invoked. And if you like have custom plugins that take a lot of time, that makes sense to use that. There's a little bit simplified version we also provide that actually what it does is, like, for example, it sums up some things like you are not in charge of, like things that you can't improve. For example, the Gradle infrastructure, that's something like if you use Gradle, like you stuck to the infrastructure. So that's something we simplified here. But if you figure out that takes longer than expected, like feel free to use the raw version and ping us and show us the issue. You can also share that with us in the forum, like if you see something that's super helpful for us. And you have that drop-down version, like the inverted flame graphs too, like these icicle graphs, if you want to. That's very helpful. And if you then go, like, let's check the flame graph here and that flame graph here. Yeah, so that's my new configuration, and that's my old one. So I see, like, I improved something here in the I/O operations, just for a demo issue. So that now finished, and here you get the links to those flame graphs. That's super helpful. If you need to go into details, the Gradle profiler supports different kinds of profiling options. Like you can use Gradle build scans. It's actually quite limited to what you can get. Like it obviously does not go into detail as you would use JProfiler or something. So that creates you those images you can look into, find memory leaks or whatever. Yeah, very useful. So now we optimized the configuration time as much as possible. Now let's look into execution time. So task execution in Gradle should in general be incremental, ideally cacheable, I talk about that later, and parallelizable. Like you should be able to invoke the build in parallel, like invoke multiple tasks at once and run in parallel. So since most of you are already on Gradle, I can skip that slide actually. Like, don't use clean build. That's for, tell your colleagues still on Maven or something. So in build scans, you get an overview of how tasks were executed. And here you see, like, ideally, like, that's what you have when you haven't changed anything. Like, all your tasks are still up to date. They are not executed again. You save that time. Here's an example of if you look into a task and you expect it to be up to date, that build scan also tells you like why it was not up to date. So in that time, in that scenario here, it tells me that the input property timestamp has changed for task process resources. Gradle itself does not have such a task, but you might have configured something in your custom task or in that process resources task. You need to find those volatile inputs and really double check if you need them. So for example, what we have here, like I see that quite often, is that here I add a timestamp to my build. Maybe you write that in the jar metadata file or something. This makes your build not reproducible anymore, right? Because next time you invoke it, that input property has changed, Gradle invokes it again. So if you really, you should really double check if you need those timestamps or those unique IDs or something, and maybe just invoke them if you're generating a release or release trial version or whatever. But for your development builds, try to avoid that. That's super expensive. Parallelism, I talked about, like Gradle supports parallel task execution. Like if you see something like that, something is either you just haven't enabled it or something is wrong in your task wiring. And as more decoupled smaller projects you have, the more Gradle can make use of that dash dash parallel. So if you have a enterprise app, a significant time when building is actually spent on compiling for two reasons. You code a lot maybe, but also like usually your colleagues code a lot and your dependencies change and you need to compile again even though you haven't done anything. So if you modularize your project properly, you can make use of something we call compile avoidance. And depending on how you have decoupled your code, Gradle offers like incremental compilation. But that is like really depending on how you have structured your code. So that's something, you can't really look into that. But like, for example, compile avoidance is something I can maybe demo you to show you what I mean by that. So I have a project here and actually quite big one, but just use a sub-project here. So I'm in sub-project 2 and I have a dependency on sub-project 1, right? So, and now I run compile Java. Can you actually see my screen good enough? Let me do that again. So, okay, now I executed it before, so what I see is like everything is up to date. I compile the dependent project, which is subproject 1, up to date, my task also up to date, so I don't need to compile anything. So now let's go into actually that project here. Like now I'm in project 1. Let's make it simple for now. Like I want to change a comment, like a changed comment. Do I recompile or do I not? louder, not so shy. No, right? Like worst case, yes, but I wouldn't demo it if fingers crossed. Okay, good. So I actually recompile the project itself. Like project one, I recompile because the source file changed. But what I can already see is that the bytecode has not changed because the generated jar out of that is the same. Like that goes not into the jar. So in the jar is actually the input to the dependent project. So that also doesn't change. So that already, like, you can imagine in that case, it's simple. It's like one on one dependency. But if you narrow that down, like you have a, like what I actually have here is a project where I have generated, where I have subproject 99 depends on 98 and so on. So if I invoke the last one, like it gets super expensive on a minor change on the very core of my project. Damn it. So next thing, what if I remove that public method? Would I need to recompile? Sorry, what? It's a good point. So the way Grail works, like it is recompiled. So what we do when we compile a project or when we generate a dependency is we generate what we called an ABI, like a binary interface, like that actually tells you if that has changed. So in that binary interface between subproject one and subproject two has actually changed because a public method is part of that binary interface, right? But on the same side, like if I add or remove a private method, it's actually not. Like if I change a private method in subproject one, I should not need to recompile project two, right? I'm not talking about testing here. You still need to test that it actually works, I guess. But the compiling aspect can be avoided because the public interface of project one has not changed. And so here we have project dependencies on that level. And I can even, like, even if I change something here, like, just something stupid. What I do is I change a public method. What? Damn it. So I change a public method, but I don't change the interface. I only change the implementation detail. So I don't need to recompile. So that works for project dependencies. But actually, the nice part here is like, do I need to recompile if I update that version here? Like, that's a dependency. Oh, sorry. Let's make that here. Do I need to recompile now again? No? Yes? Actually, it's a little bit tricky question because it actually depends on what has changed in that version. Like, ideally, in the bug fix version, not so much in the public API. But actually, here in that case, between 25 and 26, nothing in the public, in the binary interface of that API or of that jar has not changed. So what we do is we resolve that dependency, but what we take into account in the inputs is not the whole jar, just the binary interface. And that really breaks like these cascades of recompilation if you change something in your sub-project. I find that pretty cool. So, and last but not least, so we talk about builds up to date, being incremental, like don't build what you have built first. Like ideally, you can take that a step further. So that's where we introduce like Gradle build cache. So that should enable you not just reuse inputs that you've done in your just before invocation of Gradle, but also like maybe you've done yesterday or maybe on a different branch or something. So let me show you that part. So what you can do is like in your setting scripts, you can configure a build cache. In that case, it's like a directory build cache, like it's directory based, pretty similar to what we have with the input tasks. Clapping already, damn it. But what you can also have is like a remote build cache. So what you have here is like, here you have a local one, file-based, pretty simple. And here what I do is like, I configure a build cache of type HTTP. I give it a URL where that cache is available. And then I configure it that I say, okay, if I have a remote cache, usually I don't want every committer or every developer to push into that. A typical pattern is to just let the CI server push into that. So if you come in the office in the morning and the nightly build, luckily for you, has finished, I hope, you don't get that hour to spend to have a drink or something, like have a coffee. Like you can start coding because actually it resolves this logic. So the way you can use that actually, I think I don't have time for a demo. So we provide a public Docker image that is a reference implementation of that build cache. You can run that from Docker anywhere you want. Let's do that quickly. Just a second. So what you get is like, you get that overview here. You have some configuration options, pretty basic. You can have cache access controls, something like that. You can declare like how many artifacts you want to store, how big. So with that, you can start immediately, like from like tomorrow when you're back in, tomorrow, Saturday, bad, Monday. So you can start with that. On top of that, if you have like Gradle Enterprise, like our commercial offering, we provide a build cache in a federated way. For example, like we are in a distributed team. So we have build caches in Europe, in Australia, and in the US. And what we do is actually, what you can do is like, you can say, okay, something in Europe was changed and we push it actively to the node in Australia because they have pretty shitty internet, even worse than in Germany. So they can make use of that. And you get additional analysis tools so that you can see how much you benefit from it. And last but not least, like if you have people on Maven, poor lost souls, since February now, we support this build scans also for Maven. Like this was a Gradle talk, like I don't talk about Maven, not as much as I can avoid it. So there's Enterprise for Maven now. And what it also offers, like the build cache also works for Maven, so you can make use of that, or your colleagues that are not using Maven can use that. To wrap things up, like once you optimize your performance, you need to keep track of it. One option is obviously server statistics. Check that with your, Team City, Jenkins, whatever tool you use. Another option is, again, like Gradle Enterprise. If you would use that, like we have views to watch performance over time in, a more Gradle fine-grained manner that multi-purpose build tools can, or multi-purpose build servers cannot provide. And we like also provide like insights to, or you see all the builds of your colleague and see where people struggle with, especially in an environment where you have a dedicated build tool team and developers, that's very useful. And yeah, that's Gradle for Maven. Oh, I have that twice on my slides. So there are plenty of resources you can now continue to look into. Like we have plenty of guides. And there are like, especially that build cache topic, we have free webinars on our website. And even if you don't want to, if you're not on time, like they're all recorded and you can watch them for free afterwards. Like these are already happened and there are like constantly things coming up. And that's actually it. I think, yeah, scans.gradle.com, use that, and then spasiba. I have 5 minutes for questions. Yeah.
Бегу. Слушайте, я еще хотел предупредить, не убегайте сразу, как только кончится вопрос, я небольшую презентацию покажу вам.
Exactly.
How do snapshot dependencies do affect the build time? And do I better use snapshot dependencies or fixed version dependencies?
That's a good question. In Gradle, the default is that if you have a snapshot dependency, Gradle would not look that up again for 24 hours. Like, that's our default, right? The problem is with snapshot dependencies, if they need to be resolved, like, usually you need to rebuild as you go. Like, but the good thing now is with that compile avoidance we have, is that it depends really on what changes you make. Like, if you have an internal change, like you work on implementation in your snapshot dependencies, it's actually not as bad because we wouldn't recompile because we noticed that between those snapshots, the public API has not changed. Yeah, does that answer your question? But in general, I try to avoid snapshot dependencies as much as possible. Yeah.
Hello, thank you for your report. Short question, Groovy or Kotlin, what do you prefer and what do you think will be more popular in future?
That's a good question. I guess here I'm more in the Kotlin corner. I'm using Gradle, or I'm working with Gradle now for 10 years. For me, it's personally hard to move away from my Groovy habits, but just like out of convenience, like I speak Groovy natural, like fluent, and Kotlin not yet so much. If you start with Gradle, it's actually up to you. I think I would go with Kotlin if I start. First of all, the original reason why we did that, or why we started supporting Kotlin, was first, it has better IDE support. And I like the static aspect of it. Like, for example, especially if you work for Gradle or if you work on Gradle, like all the dynamic logics that Groovy offers, like as I said earlier, I don't use them at all and we don't use them in Gradle itself, like this method missing logic or thing. I would go with Kotlin now if I start a new project, let's say. And also, like, if you use Kotlin in production already or Groovy, it depends a bit on that, right? I wouldn't build a Grails project maybe written with a Kotlin DSL. I know there's a, like, I know, no, don't get started. Like, there was a big fight that in the Groovy team, like, one guy, like, actually from our team introduced a Kotlin build script, like, sub, and they went nuts about that. But, yeah. Any other questions?
Hello.
Yeah.
I actually don't use Gradle in production. I Scala guy. I use SBT. But my question is about monorepo.
About what?
Monorepo.
Monorepo.
One repo that contains many projects.
Yeah.
I wear an impression about remote caching.
Yeah.
And what do you think about comparison for this target of Gradle and Bazel? Bazel is a Google build tool.
That's a good question. I think that I personally, like, I would use Gradle. Surprise. I think Bazel has a valid point here. The thing is that I think it's way more fine-grained. Like, the maintenance is also quite high because it's very explicit what you do, and it's also quite limited in what you can do. Performance-wise, actually, I'm too thin on, like, I can't speak for Bazel, actually. Like, I think they are very close to each other, and it really, like, I had that question earlier in an interview, that the performance really depends on the project structure. You have something to add to that discussion?
Okay.
I couldn't hear you. Sorry. Can you? I think our time is up.
Can I ask another
yeah.
question about?
Well, you can try.
You use compile Java.
Yeah.
And, it works great for detection of incompatible changes in
yeah.
interfaces. Does it work for Kotlin or Scala or another works?
Yes, actually, I didn't cover that because it was not an introduction talk. But usually, what you do is like it works for all these. Actually, all these they shut down my project. It works for all of those, and like if you write a custom task for whatever you need to do, there's a public API you can use to make your task cacheable and incremental and have all that support built in. Yeah, yeah.